Dobro večer, dame i gospodo. Uvijek sad se i previše čujemo. Danas nekoliko uvodnih riječi prije početka ovog programa. Juče je završio peti Subverziv Film Festival. Molim vas da gromoglasnim aplauzom pozdravimo ekipu koja je sudjelovala u realizaciji festivala. Od danas pa sve do subote, međunarodna konferencija pod nazivom Budućnost Europe, a od ponedjeljka do petka Subverziv forum. Koristim ovu priliku da se zahvalim, kao i obično, gradu Zagrebu, Gradskom uredu za obrazovanje, kulturu i sport, Ministarstvu kulture, HAVC-u i Turističkoj zajednici grada Zagreba. Zatim našim medijskim pokroviteljima, našim medijskim pokroviteljima, Večernjem listu i forumu i naročito te portalu i T-komu koji su nam omogućili live streaming ove godine, to je Breaking News. Svaki dan ako ne stignete na predavanje moći ćete to pogledati na našem www.subverzivfestivalu.com. Zatim koristim ovu priliku također da se zahvalim našim partnerima. Naši partneri su ove godine po treći put Heinrich Bell zaklada, po drugi put Rosa Luxemburg zaklada i po drugi put Transform iz Beča. Sada ću dati za sve detaljnije i opširnije, dajem riječ Srećku Horvatu koji se ne slaže sa pozicijom direktora ni šefa, ali najavit ću ga kao mog unbeatable frienda. Srećko Horvat.
Pa evo, meni je jako drago da je konačno prošli tjedan završio, svi smo bili jako nestrpljivi i zapravo neki od nas su jedva čekali da filmski program završi i da konačno krene konferencija. Nisam pripremio nikakav govor, nego bih kao i Mišo ove godine istaknuo da se više na Subverziv festivalu ne radi samo o teorijskim predavanjima, niti samo o intelektualcima koji stižu u Zagreb sad već svake godine, nego se prije svega radi o formiranju moguće alternative i promišljanja moguće alternative sadašnjem stanju Europske unije konkretno. Zato se ove godine s nama mreža Transform, koja okuplja nekoliko više od desetak organizacija diljem Europe, Attack, Memory Deluxe, vjerojatno sam krivo izgovorio, European Alternatives, Eurozine, Rosa Luxemburg, Heinrich Böll Stiftung, niz drugih organizacija koje sam također vjerojatno propustio spomenuti. Također velika je novost, kao što je Mišo rekao, da imamo live stream koji se može pratiti i na našoj stranici i na stranici te portala, ali što mi je izuzetno drago i na stranici izdavačke kuće Verso. Još što sam zaboravio spomenuti, dakle, osim ovoga glavnoga programa u kinu Europa, koji se nažalost naplaćuje, ali živimo u uvjetima kapitalizma pa moramo plaćati dvoranu i tisuću drugih stvari. Osim toga, zato upravo postoji live streaming, ali ono što je meni osobno najvažnije i pogotovo timu koji radi na Subverziv festivalu i svim ljudima koji su došli ove godine, jest program koji se zbiva u ZKM-u svaki dan već od sutra u 10 ujutro do 6 popodne. Zato jer tamošnji događaji nisu formirani kao ex katedra predavanja, već kao otvorene diskusije na koje su pozvani svi zainteresirani subjekti i subjektice, da budem politički korektan. Tamo će se dakle prva dva dana odvijati diskusija o krizi Europe, sa nama su brdo zanimljivih ljudi, aktivista, intelektualca, od Bernata Kasena, Samira Mina, Erika Tusana, do brojnih drugih, to je prva dva dana. Treći dan u srijedu imamo cijeli dan posvećen commonsima, što je čini mi se takako aktualna tema i u Hrvatskoj, posebice s obzirom na najave novih privatizacija, ne samo tvornica, nego i čitavih sektora poput energetike, voda, obrazovanja, zdravstva i svega ostalog što možete zamisliti. Dakle, u srijedu raspravljamo o tome. Dolazi niz svjetskih komonera koji su stručnjaci za to i završit ćemo u srijedu sa velikim okruglim stolom sa Michaelom Hartom, Kostasom Dozinasom, Segolen Pruvo. Vjerojatno sam i ovo krivo izgovorio, a ono što je čini mi se ove godine najvažniji dio Subverziv festivala, premda se to možda na prvi pogled ne čini, posebice s obzirom na ovako renomirane govornike kao što su Tarik Ali i Slavoj Žižek koji će večeras biti s nama, jest nešto što smo naveli Balkan forum prema Balkanskom socijalnom forumu, to je dakle četvrtak i petak u ZKM-u gdje će se okupiti više od 40 različitih organizacija i pokreta sa čitavog Balkana, iz Makedonije, Slovenije, Kosova, Albanije, Srbije, Bosne i Hercegovine i mnogih drugih država, gdje ćemo zapravo pokušati ne samo oformiti, nego i raspravljati o nekakvoj mogućoj platformi koja bi objedinila sve različite subjekte od sindikata, studentskog pokreta itd. No da ne duljim, velika mi je čast što mogu pozvati ministricu kulture Andreju Zlatar da i službeno otvori konferenciju i da nam se svima zajedno obrati.
Dobro večer svima. Beskreno sam sretna što sam večeras ovdje sa vama. Svake godine sam znala kada traje Subverted Film Festival, jer je to bio onaj tjedan ili ona dva tjedna kada su studenti nestajali iz mojih klupa. Naprosto dva tjedna nikoga. I to je jedan od znakova zašto i kako i za koga se ovo radi. Imam naravno večeras i formalne zadatke. Oni nisu formalni u smislu toga što ih moram ispuniti, nego zato što doista želim zahvaliti osobno onima koji su odlučili dati svoje znanje, svoje razmišljanja i svoju želju za razgovorom i diskusijom podijeliti sa svima nama. U ovom tjednu bit će ih više, ali večeras bih specijalno htjela pozdraviti one koji su danas ovdje sa nama. To su gospodin Slavoj Žižek, gospodin gospodin Tarik Ali, gospodin Bernard Cassin i gospodin Samir Amin. Tri velike asocijacije i grupe koje posebno želim pozdraviti, to je predstavnik Eurozina ili Eurozina, časopisa koji se bavi socijalnim i kulturnim pitanjima na elektronskoj bazi, u smislu dostupan je svima ovdje i gdje će, nadam se, naći partnere za bolju suradnju među svima nama. I tu su naravno predstavnici platforme, ataka i drugih organizacija koje upravo sa sobom vode sve one koji znaju da treba misliti. Reći ću samo nekoliko rečenica. Malo se naravno i ja osjećam čudno s ove strane, puno je ugodnije i zanimljivije sjediti, slušati i razmišljati kod kuće i sami sa prijateljima o tome gdje smo, kako živimo i što nas čeka. Ali ono što je najvažnije, rekla bih i ono slično Srećku, pa ja sam čekala da prođe filmski dio, da dođe ovaj teorijski, ok. Ali i Srećko je sam napisao dosta knjiga o filmu i o teoriji, tako da su te dvije stvari očito nemalo isprepletene. Međutim, ono što je strahovito važno, to je da shvatimo da moramo razmišljati o ovome gdje smo sad i da za to ne postoje rješenja, nego da od jedne situacije ujutro do situacije naveče se stvari mijenjaju. Da ne možemo stvarati sustav ili model koji će nam riješiti sve i onda se pouzdat u to da će neko drugi raditi stvari umjesto nas, nego da cijelo vrijeme moramo imati taj jedan refleksivni moment prema onome što sami radimo, prema onome što rade drugi. Na meni i na nama koji smo u ovom trenutku igrom političkih okolnosti na funkciji takozvane izvršne vlasti, na nama je da osiguramo tu mogućnost i da upravo otvorimo prostor za ono što se danas najčešće u svijetu naziva platformama, tipom participativnog tipa diskusije, onoga gdje možemo razgovarati i gdje nove ideje mogu ići naprijed. Ne možemo riješiti stvari tako da gledamo neke modele koji su negdje drugdje profunkcionirali, moramo točno i precizno vidjeti kako je kod svakoga kod nas, u svakom gradu, u svakoj zemlji, jer su stvari drugačije nego što se čine na prvi pogled i ne možemo tražiti rješenja koje će dugo trajati, jer ne postoje rješenja koje dugo traje, postoji život koji je svaki dan novi iz početka, a a mislim da svi večeras ovdje koji ste tu, oni koji nas gledaju putem drugih novih tehnoloških mogućnosti, da znaju da je upravo to naš posao, a to je da živimo najkvalitetnije što možemo i mislimo o tome. Želim vam fantastične diskusije, a ja ću to vjerojatno preko ljeta pregledavati u nekoj od snimaka. Sve dobro vam festivalu, uz sve čestitke, naravno, organizatorima. Neću izdvojiti samo ovu ekipu, dakle Nikolu i Srećka, nego sve one koji su u tome sudjelovali, jer mislim da je ekipa velika, vrlo velikim dijelom na volonterskoj bazi, ali ono oko čega ćemo tražiti sustav, to je naravno da ovaj teorijski dio i konferencijski dio dođe na jednu razinu studijskog oblika i da imamo pravi prostor sa sigurnošću da ovaj tip znanja i ovaj tip razmišljanja postane jedna praksa koja svakoga od nas ovdje, svaku od nas ovdje naprosto ne da obvezuje, nego potiče na to da iskoračimo iz ovoga ne može se ništa, u ono nešto ipak možemo napraviti. Hvala puno.
So now is the moment to invite Slavoj and Tariq to join us at the round table. I will explain in a minute why Gianni Vattimo unfortunately isn't with us.
Do you know Marx Brothers' Night at the Opera, where the three clowns found them, and in order not to answer the questions, they just go on drinking water and more water, and that's a good beginning.
So shall we do it, or just drink water the whole night?
Maybe, in the break between drinking water we can. If we are going to drink, let's get something better than water.
For our English-speaking guests, if you didn't understand the talks before, we have simultaneous translation for all lectures here in Cinema Europa. You just give your identity card and then you get your headphones. I'm very glad to officially open the conference, and the next 6 or 7 days we will be together. And I will start by reading a letter by Gianni Vattimo, which he has sent today. Unfortunately, he is not with us. You will soon find out why. Dear Srećko, what I would say in our Zagreb meeting, to which I cannot take part directly because of a mega grip I took back from Latin America, is summarized in a sentence by Gramsci in his sole discourse to the Italian Parliament in 1925, where he had been elected just before being sentenced to 28 years of prison. He said to the fascist government, "You have brought the country, Italy, to the ruin. Only communism now can save it." Europe is now in a very similar situation, and the forces which brought it to this point are always the same. International capitalism masked under different names, but basically oriented by the same purpose, towards the same end, an end in both senses of the word, the objective to obtain the increasing richness of the rich, but unfortunately also an end as the final destruction of the resources of the planet and of the hopes of our generation and of the future ones. Subversion seems now to be the sole possible realistic policy, although not as a general revolution, which we don't exclude, I think, but which is not in the range of the immediate possibilities. Subversion should be now a general intensification of social indiscipline in order to put limits and obstacles to the destroying machine of the invasion of capitalism in all aspects of our lives. This is the sole way for saving Europe from its progressive suicide. Citizens, in all disturbing ways they can imagine, such as local struggles against the destruction of nature and communities, let me remember the struggle of the population of the Italian Valle di Susa against the useless and genocidical project of a new tunnel in the Alps, have to take the word, making themselves heard by the governments before it's too late. Have a good Subversion Festival. Gianni Vattimo. So first, before we come to the more serious questions and more complicated questions, I would ask Tariq and Slavoj to make a short comment on our comrades' message to the Subversive Festival. You. Okay, now it's Monty Python show again, but.
Just really a brief comment, since Gianni already mentioned Gramsci, maybe there is another famous proposition from Gramsci, which also, I think, it's as if it's meant to characterize our moment. You know that famous phrase by Gramsci where he said that in times when the old is dying, but the new is not yet here, this is the times in this in-between space where monsters are appearing. And I think this is effectively our time of Europe now. The old is dying. That is to say, a certain form of capitalism which appeared to have won in 1990. The, let's call it, Fukuyama moment. Don't take it personally. I have even a minimal appreciation of Fukuyama because he now at least admits that he was wrong. He openly says that in view of what's going on now, his vision of the end of history is a dream. It's out. So that epoch is out. If you want the most ironic comment on it, it would have been that, yes, maybe capitalism won, but the example of China and some other countries demonstrates that nonetheless the old hardline communists are the best managers of this capitalism. No, so that we are getting almost the worst of both worlds. What I mean is that effectively all monsters from Breivik in Norway, but don't dismiss him as a monster in the sense of pathology. He was, I think, if you look at his manifesto, very, within his own terms, rational, systematic analyst from his extreme right-wing perspective of what goes in Europe from his perspective. I think that dismissing him as a madman is precisely avoiding the problem. And I think he, Breivik, maybe we should also do this, deserves a close analysis. Because he is the moment of truth in the sense of tendencies that others are not ready to draw. He draws them. Let's take the very sensitive point, the Middle East conflict, Israel and Palestinians. As I already said this afternoon on the TV show, but it needs repeating. Are you aware what radical position Breivik has here? He is, to cut it shortly, an anti-Semitic Zionist. Literally, totally supports Israel. He said, Israel is the last line of defense against Arab Islamic fundamentalist invasion, so we should throw all Palestinians from the West Bank, the new temple of Jerusalem. But, he said, here in the West, there is a problem with the Jews. He said, continental Europe is okay, meaning Hitler did his job, but he said England is so-so, and United States, my God, 6 million Jews, that's too much. They will have to deal with the problem. Now, if you think this is an exception, it's not. It's, I would say, the most succinct, in clear form, characterization of actual Western politics towards Israel, like, you do your dirty job there, and allow us to pursue our racism here. And the sad thing is that, and this is for me a true tragedy, one of the tragedies of the Middle East, that at least part of the Zionist establishment accepts this game. Like, we leave you a little bit of your anti-Semitism there if you allow us to just follow your rules here and finish with Palestinians here. Okay, I will not lose time here. All I want to say is that another lesson, and then I stop, from Gramsci would have been, don't allow the enemy to define the space of debate of how we perceive problems. You know, often we hear we live in the era of a conflict between open, multiculturalist, liberal democracy and irrational fundamentalism. The beginning of a serious analysis is that, no, this is not the conflict. This is a false, fake conflict. Someone is missing here. The left is missing. This is the conflict between liberal mainstream and fundamentalist reactions, which are clearly part of the inherent dynamic of this mainstream. This is what Gramsci clearly saw, and he would also have seen that I talk too much, so I stop.
No, you don't talk too much. But exactly this brings me to my question to Tariq Ali. On the one hand, we see Breivik is not an exception, of course. For example, in Greece, on the recent elections, the Golden Dawn got even 7% of votes. And they're infamous for beating up immigrants in Greece and so on. On this same side, we have the rise of the neoliberalism again, austerity measures, structural reforms, and so on. But on the other hand, especially in Greece, we had also the example of Syriza, which got 17%. And we also have an example from France with Hollande. So my question is, some of our friends who are coming tomorrow, Kostas Douzinas, is claiming we can speak about European Spring. You have, Tariq, written a lot on Arab Spring and also about Europe, and the title of your lecture is The Rotten Heart of Europe. But do you think we can speak about European Spring, and how do you comment the recent results of elections in Greece and in France? Do you think it will change things?
Well, I think the situation in Greece is very interesting. Even as we are gathered here, massive maneuvers are taking place within the Greek elite to try and force a coalition of parties who did not get a majority. With the democratic left, if they succeed in dragooning them into a new coalition, they will have a majority of one. So I hope that the democratic left, which is a split from PASOK, will say no, because the position so far taken by Syriza is a principled position, which usually is missing from politics these days, which is to say that the Greek people have voted against the two main parties of Greece, the two historic parties, New Democracy and PASOK. The people don't want them, and it would be undemocratic to impose a government made of these people. But that is exactly what is being attempted. And Slavo is absolutely right. What we are witnessing is the slow death, the agony of this neoliberal capitalist system, which everyone knows can't work, doesn't work, is making people's lives absolutely miserable, and something which is struggling to be born, to offer an alternative. In, you know, look at Greece, it's a country of 10 million people. Half of them live in Athens. 300,000 people marched on the streets of Athens. There have been two general strikes. In small and big cities, people have been out. That is the closest you have to a spring mood, if you like, in that country. And still, they have not been able. Maybe, you know, I think a new election will probably solve matters. Either two choices, either an election in which Syriza gets 20-25%, and then because of the way the Greek system works, an additional 50 seats, so they will be close with the democratic left to forming a government. Or something which has not happened so far in Western Europe for a long, long time, is, and I thought about this when the Greek business began, I said, will they take a city? The demonstrators. Will they be strong enough to take Thessaloniki, to have an elected popular government, not within the parliamentary framework, but outside it, and to show the rest of Greece, this is how we run a city and create. That has not happened. And in the absence of that, you then have everyone concentrating on the elections, which is normal, which is normal. So it's an interesting situation now developing in Europe. And in France, you know, it's not the Hollande victory I'm so interested in, to be honest. I think Hollande is essentially a sort of slightly dull apparatchik from the French Socialist Party without much vision at all. And the fact that he's defeated Sarkozy is important because the incumbent has been defeated. This has been the pattern, defeat the incumbents. So that pattern has been fulfilled. For me, the more interesting thing in the French election is that the campaign fought by Jean-Luc Mélenchon and the Left Front has shown that it is possible to mobilize young people again for politics. Some of the demonstrations that we saw and what was said at them was strong. Okay, he won 11%. It's not sufficient, but it's an important start. And in France, you always have three or four rounds. First round, second round presidential, third round parliamentary, fourth round another parliamentary. And if none of that works, the fifth round often is the streets and the barricades. And if this government doesn't deliver anything, then we shall see what will happen. It's very interesting. You know, you see what German ideologues of the government and of the elite, Christoph, I've forgotten his Schonmann, who is a jurist from Constance, writes in the very influential German official magazine, Merkur, the theoretical magazine of the German bourgeoisie, if you like, very intelligent. And Schoenfeld writes, we should treat the French like Bismarck treated the Bavarians. That is the way we should treat the French. Now, of course, you can say that Bismarck occasionally treated the Bavarians very well, but he had total contempt for them. And one of the most famous remarks by Bismarck in relation to Bavarians was, these Bavarians are half Austrian and half men. That's what they are, so we will win them over, flatter them, give them money, get them around. And this is what the advisors of Merkel are saying, how you should treat the French. So I think they will say to Hollande, oh, we are friends, you can have a little bit of stimulus in your program, that's fine, it's not a problem for us. But as far as any deep-going structural changes are made, deep-going structural reforms that are needed in the French system, which Mélenchon proposed in the campaign, no, remain far from it. So there is everything to fight for, in my opinion, and we are just seeing the beginning.
Very briefly, if I may, just a couple of points. First, also as part of the prolonged polite introduction, but I mean it seriously. I think we both with Tariq share an opinion. I mean, as a rule, and it comes with the role, the post you occupy, ministers are idiots, even if you are not an idiot. So it's nice to see a minister where you feel in a palpable way this gap between the role and how you act. All my sympathy for the tragic role, but you must be lucky to have such a minister. In my country, Slovenia, just across the border, we have a minister who fully fits his role at this moment. Okay, let me go on with more serious stuff. I liked it that they are beneath contempt. They published, a guy called Jörg Lau there, 10 years ago, a text against me, Žižek nach dem Suche nach dem guten Terror, where they literally proclaimed me a supporter of Al-Qaeda and so on and so on, and so much for their democracy. I wrote them a very short, polite reply, none of the polemic with regard to content, just showing where they simply falsify my line of argumentation, the standard type, you know. You took a fragment where I undoubtedly describe the position of the enemy, and they attributed to me, and of course, not only there, not one German media was ready to publish my very short reply. So much about that. Also, what you said about Bismarck and Bavaria, I hope this guy that you quoted from Merkur didn't mean this. Correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't there in 1866 even a war between Bavaria and Bismarck? And Bismarck, so I hope they don't mean this with with France. No? Okay, which was followed by the war against France, of course. Okay, more seriously. First, about what you said about neoliberalism. I hope you agree that there is one point more which is crucial, and many intelligent economists, by intelligent I mean more intelligent than me in economic matters at least, have clearly pointed this out. When we criticize neoliberalism, we should always be aware that we are criticizing an ideology. Ideology in the sense that if you look closely at what states which refer to neoliberalism are effectively doing, they are not really following neoliberalism. Of course, they do to some extent education, healthcare, and so on. But at the same time, if you look at their military, economic politics, and so on, the state is getting stronger and stronger, intervenes, so it's neoliberalism. It's neoliberalism when you want to ruin, screw your own healthcare system, your own education, whatever. It's definitely not neoliberalism when you want to steer to regulate your economy. It's full of most ruthless cheating, especially where so-called third world countries are most exposed to being terrorized in economy. United States neoliberal. Are you kidding me? Sorry if I repeat an old story, but I remember some 10 years ago, I saw on CNN, these were the times when CNN was marginally better than others. Now it's totally the same. It looks more that Al Jazeera is the old CNN, marginally better. Okay, on CNN, I saw a wonderful report about Mali, African state, where their minister of economy was explaining, we produce excellent cotton, inexpensive. How can we succeed when United States is, with all their free market against state support rhetorics, is giving to their farmers, because they come mostly from Republican-dominated states, more financial support than the entire state budget of Mali. And he said, listen, we don't need any help, socialist measures, just follow a little bit your own liberal rules. And so, you know, we should always be aware of this, that this neoliberalism in the sense of more rule to the market, less state intervention, this is not the reality. The reality, at least in economy, matters of defense, is quite often the opposite one. And now a more up to the point, shorter point about Greece. Greece, I think, is also very interesting today as a study of the rhetorics of narratives of those in power. Look at our predominant media. What narratives do we read about the Greek crisis? First, it's the, let's call it, although I wouldn't blame only Germans, the German technocratic narrative. Lazy Greeks living from Europe. Now when the bill arrives, they don't want to pay it. Lazy Greeks and so on. And when I was in Germany, this may amuse you. I even engaged, I like sometimes to go as low as to accept the disgusting racist topic. I told them, okay, let me go down to your level. Greeks lazy. Sorry, but if you even start to think at this, you know, racist problematic, which, what is the majority of Greece? Mountains with not enough soil and so on. To survive there, sorry, you have to work a lot. It's, if I may put it in these obscene terms, it's geographically, geologically not a lazy country. But okay, not really. What I want to say is that this is the first. The second discourse is also false. A certain defense of Greece, which takes, I think, a wrong nationalist turn. We Greeks are now the victim of Europe. This is the second German occupation, and so on and so on. This sounds, you know, first was Hitler occupation, now it's financial occupation. It sounds nice, but it avoids the problem, which is that precisely Greece is not just a singular case of a victim out there. Greece is what in educated political philosophy we call the universal exception. It appears as an exception, but it's a model, it's the te fabula narratur. It's a model for us all. Capitalism, global capitalism is in a crisis, and it, as it were, tests spontaneously different models. Like Greece is a kind of a rabbit where they are testing the model of systematically turning a country into a third world country, dismantling the whole welfare state, imposing a non, de facto suspending democracy, and so on and so on. This is the point. And the third one, I warn you about this one, don't underestimate it. The third rhetoric, the most disgusting for me, the charity human suffering rhetoric. All of a sudden, Western media discovered about half a year ago, even less, I would say, that people in Greece suffer. My God, there are children who don't have enough medicines and so on. And I warn you, there will be soon maybe humanitarian actions, like save a Greek child, drink for the price of two cappuccinos, you can make a difference, and so on and so on. Sorry, no, Greeks are not suffering. They are, but they are fighting. And to treat them like this is the most disgusting. Now, my conclusion, believe it or not, even I stop at some point. Would you agree with this? Here, I will give now a very sensitive advice, which maybe will cost me again the insult of being totalitarian secretly or what, but I like very much what the two of you, especially you, said about elections. Yes, up to a point, we should respect elections, blah, blah. But you know, especially in an open situation like this, where you don't get a conclusive answer by electoral machinery alone, it is crucial, to be very brutal and clear, to retain a strong popular mobilization and pressure inclusive of certain forms of violence, not violence of killing people, but violence of occupying public spaces, bringing normal flow of things to an end, which would prevent the type of manipulations that you, Tariq, hinted at. This kind of unprincipled, under pressure coalition, and so on and so on. Here is a clear case for me of how all the solution will not simply come from electoral process. An additional popular pressure is needed. And I know we will be accused here of undemocratic pressure. I'm not afraid of it, because let's be clear. The message, important message of Occupy Wall Street, we tend to forget that it was a double message. The message is not only, and this is already a great message, you know, till now mass protests were mostly one issue protest against war in Iraq, against racism, blah, blah. This is something new in the developed West. This is a mass movement whose insight is basically that there is some structural, deep structural flaw in the capitalist system as such. And point two, this is also what people don't like to hear, that the way democracy that we have today, the institutionalized democratic system, is not strong enough to deal with the ongoing. This is not a call for totalitarianism. This is just a warning that if we don't invent new forms of democratic self-organization pressure, then totalitarianism will come. You know that. We have capitalism with Asian values, which has nothing to do with Asia. It's just a poetic expression of authoritarian system, which is coming nearer and nearer. Now we have in Hungary capitalism with Hungarian values. We are already capitalism with Italian values, somewhere between Berlusconi and Monti, and all around Europe, this type of values are waiting. So would you agree or not that this is a clear case of how, without any illusion of direct Leninist takeover, of where democracy alone cannot do the job, an additional pressure is needed?
That has always been my opinion, Slavoj. I have always believed that on its own, parliaments do not deliver. It is when you have mobilizations outside. After all, that is the history of democracy itself. It is not something that was handed down from above. It is something that people had to struggle for, in some cases for centuries, in the United States, to get black people the right to vote, against killings, against lynchings, all that. And in a country which is said to be the mother place, the motherland of democracy, Great Britain, they needed revolutions to break the hold of the rich. They needed constant struggles from below to win the right even to vote for adult franchise. So the whole history of democracy itself is that it would not have been made possible for struggle. The right of women to vote, how did the women achieve that? Strong extra-parliamentary movements waged by women. And women didn't get the right to vote till the 20th century. So with the democracy that we have today, a democracy which cannot deliver what its people require, and a democracy from which the young generation from the age of 18 to 26 is increasingly alienated, you do need mass mobilizations from below, and if possible, you need alternative institutions of power outside that system, not to wage a civil war against it, but to say that with this, we are discussing real issues and real things and taking actions. I think that that is extremely important. But you know, it's also the case, that's why I said what I said, that during the Greek uprising, it is a great pity they didn't take one city. I repeat that. Especially a city with long traditions like Thessaloniki. Athens, of course, would have been brilliant because that's half the country. But if they had done that, the results would have been much, much more dramatic than the recent election results, in my opinion. But we shall see, because this is the beginning of a new process that we are witnessing. I agree with you very strongly, let me say that, on these stupid attacks on the Greeks for being lazy. I mean, this is a country which was wrecked by the Second World War. Wrecked. And after the Second World War, many of those who had collaborated with German fascism, collaborated with the new system that was being set up. And the civil war in Greece that followed the Second World War crushed the left brutally. In 1947-48, as late as that, Greek militias, backed by the Western governments, were being sent into villages to drag out members of the resistance who had fought with the communist and the non-communist resistance against the fascists. They were being dragged out of their villages. Hundreds of thousands of Greek people left their country to go and work in car factories in Australia. So they are not lazy. In fact, they are rather alert. And today, the Greeks who are the best off are the ones getting their pensions from Australia because they're not dependent on their own state. And I agree also with you. Of course, the word neoliberal has, you know, become meaningless in a sense. What we are talking about is the latest form of capitalism, which has functioned largely through financializations, excessive dependence on financialization, excessive dependence on the use of fictitious capital, no money, fake money to make more money, a housing bubble that was constructed on the basis of this financialization, which broke in the United States and which is now broken in Spain. And the financial press was saying about Spain, not so long ago, 8-9 years ago, the Financial Times, The Economist, was saying about Spain, the Spanish bull is very vibrant, unlike the dying lions of old Europe. This was the bull. This was the economy which was going to show the way forward, and that economy is in a state of collapse because Spain is now in an extremely serious state with between 25 to 30% of young people out of work, with some cities not being able to afford to pay its municipal workers who are cleaning sometimes the streets free just so they can live in a halfway decent environment. That is the situation Europe is in, and in this situation, the European elites have not understood the scale of the problem. They just haven't understood it.
No, I would just like to support what you said about bubble, house bubble and so on, that I'm almost getting paranoiac here. First, I noticed how the countries where the crisis did strike at its harshest were, as a rule, just a couple of months before, celebrated as the most vibrant, successful. For example, you know, I am this elephant with mean, evil memory. I remember Iceland. 2 months before outbreak, a respected Slovene economist advised our phone company, because there were international bidders who will take it over, the national privatization and so on, to accept the Iceland offer, claiming this is a stable, secure country, do this. Then we have Egypt. I remember, I have mean memory, 1 month before the outbreak, there were big news in the economies there. The IMF that Egypt is showing signs of progress and so on and so on. Not to mention Tunis, which was all the time the darling and so on. So it's very weird how it's not in some marginal, impoverished countries. The crisis explodes precisely in the countries which are picked out as the model. And what worries me is, and it's not a nice prospect for all of us maybe, is China the next? China also largely sustains itself by an incredible housing bubble also, I mean, investment in housing, which is already showing signs of exhaustion, like hundreds of thousands of empty flats and so on. The Chinese authorities are aware of it. I mean, forget what the media are saying, Chinese military might, they redoubled their defense budget. Yeah, but they more than tripled their internal security budget. China is now almost alone of the big states, which gives much more for internal security than for external security. You see, this is the truth of when we speak about the inherent antagonism, dialectic of capitalism, we old Marxists, we are not totally bullshitting. This is the reality of it, that precisely when thing appears at its most dynamic, the explosion is near. Namely, also this campaign now about the army in China. It is clear that the leadership is getting ready for some kind of rebellion, state of emergency, and this is why they are absolutely focused on will the army be on our side, which is why, as my Chinese friends told me, apart from free trade unions, the thing which will get you immediately arrested in China is to say the army should be neutral out of politics. Say this, you are immediately arrested. I have many other questions, but later.
I have a question as well. Yeah. I also have a question.
And by infinite mercy, I'll allow you.
Thanks a lot. So I would move forward or come back to a very important question, I think. So all over Europe, Romania, even Slovenia with the general strike, but this is not the question now. Italy, Spain, Portugal, Greece, and so on, we witness protests against new privatization. Energy sector, water, healthcare system, education, and so on. So my question for Tariq, but also for Slavoj, but first for Tariq, is how can we fight still against the new privatizations and at the same time not to fall into the trap of the welfare state illusion? I think this is an old debate among the left, and how can we succeed it?
Well, compared, let me say this, compared to what has been done to the state sector and the public sector, the fact that this latest version of capitalism in its expansionist phase, as it used to be, the way it felt it had to expand was externally, of course, through globalization, but internally, through taking back what private capital felt had been taken away from it as a result of wars, mass upheavals, etc. They did not provide the citizens of Western Europe with free health, free education, subsidized public housing, because one day they woke up and they said, we're in a nice mood, we'll give them some privileges. They did it because after the Russian Revolution, they were fearful that unless some concessions and changes were made, there might be upheavals in all the European countries too. That is when social democracy was at its most radical. With the death or the collapse of communism, social democracy collapsed as well, and more or less gave up, was in favor of all the privatizations. The guy who privatized large numbers of enterprises and institutions in France was Dominique Strauss-Kahn. Then the finance minister of France, and now a trader in young women. That's what he did, essentially. The people who did it in Britain were first Thatcher, carried on by Blair. So there is now no longer any illusion that dismantle and get rid of this system and find a set of transitions to something else. It's not an easy question, neither for us or for good economists. It's a difficult one, but we have to try it sometime. And one of the solutions will have to be, under progressive governments, the state actually not depending completely on fiscal measures, on taxes, but owning tracts of important tracts of poverty, of property, which is state property democratically organized. It has to be considered. There's no other solution in the intermediate period. And the big problem is that when the traditional center-left collapses and doesn't come up with it, you have the entire extreme right in Europe. How is Le Pen won over French workers? Not simply by saying immigrants are awful and Islam is an awful religion. Not only by that. Won them over by saying all the social rights you have been taken away by these corrupt politicians. The Dutch extreme right say very similar things. Geert Wilders just brought down the conservative government because he refused to vote for austerity. So when the left doesn't exist or is very weak and the center left is capitulated, the extreme right gains. That's the scale of the problem we confront. So it's a matter not just of things, but actually making democracy function. China, to come to Slavoj's point, is an interesting case because what China proves first and foremost is you don't need to have any democracy at all to have capitalism. It's fine. So this notion that capitalism and democracy are linked together like this, are inseparable, is nonsense. It always has been nonsense. This is an ideological construct which was used between 1917 and the late 1980s to hit the enemy in the entire West. The minute the enemy collapsed, this construct basically disappeared. And it doesn't function anymore, because no one cares. The people who rule do not care about democracy. France had a referendum, a very, very closely fought referendum against the European Constitution, one of the most democratic instances in recent European politics. In every single small town, villages, people went and argued. And Jürgen Habermas, the great German philosopher, appealed to the people of France, please don't leave us, please don't vote against the European Constitution. They were not voting against Europe, they were voting against a constitution which made this form of capitalism sacred. What happened after that referendum? In France, in Holland, in Ireland. What happened? It was ignored. Completely and totally ignored. They pushed through a new constitution, which was virtually the same, with one or two cosmetic changes that were made. So how can young people not be cynical? And how can they say, if this is your democracy, that whenever we vote against what you want, you ignore us? It's not a democracy that we want. The whole point of democracy was, or used to be, of getting rid of governments and, if necessary, getting rid of what they represented and changing policies. That has not been happening now. since the late 90s. It has not been happening in most of Europe, in virtually all of Europe. So that is what creates a huge problem. But you know, in relation to Greece, to come back again, I mean, for me, we have to think of a different type of European structures. I'm not in favor of any retreats to nationalism. I don't believe in that. But we have to believe in regional and Europe-wide structures, but not on the current basis. That is unacceptable. So Greece can withdraw from the euro without leaving the European Union. This thing of conflating these two things, if we withdraw from the eurozone, then we will also lose, we will be expelled. Why? Britain is not part of the eurozone. Ireland is not part. It is, but it's thinking again. Scotland, which might leave Britain, is saying we won't be part of the eurozone, though we want to be part of Europe. So it's an interesting discussion that is taking place, because when you have small countries part of the eurozone, they lose all the facility to control their own monetary policies, like devaluation. This is what Greece desperately needs. Can't do it. So this is the discussion which is taking place. So to put pressure on all the left and say, no, don't do it, when even American economists, not very radical economists like Krugman and Stiglitz, are saying devaluation is needed in Greece and Spain, but they can't do it, then we have to say, what is happening in Europe? Why are they trapped by this orthodoxy which is collapsing in front of their eyes?
Do you have a direct comment?
Conditioned by the ominous presence towards the East, no? I'm sorry that I don't know who, but I distinctly remember, I have bad memory for faces, a German friend of mine who was deep into German politics told me a wonderful story, true, about how when, a couple of years after losing power in ex-Soviet Union, Gorbachev visited Germany, and as part of this Courtois visit, at that point he was no longer general secretary, he was just going around with 2-3 bodyguards, he made, because he got no phone reply, an direct stop at Willy Brandt's villa. And Willy Brandt, through his, I don't know, servant who was there, literally didn't want to open the door. And then later they asked Brandt, how could you have done this to a guy who brought democracy? And Brandt says, no, my idea was to have a social democracy which would really provide welfare. By ruining that communist horror there, Gorbachev, I hold him personally responsible for ruining the welfare state. Because now capitalists here are no longer under. So he refused to meet Gorbachev. Like, he ruined my social. I mean, it's a little bit crazy, but it's a nice, as they say, se non è vero, è ben trovato. No, as they say. Okay, more seriously, Greece. Yes, I share your worry here. I literally think that we are getting more, you know, I'll put it like this, in the good old, I mean it ironically, I have no nostalgia for them, in the good old socialist times from my youth here, I remember how when there was an opinion poll, election, they were not free, which did not turn out right, the authorities, communists at that point, treated it more as a clinical case. If the measure proposed by communists did not pass through, it was not that the measure was wrong. How could it be? It was that, like, we didn't do the pedagogical work properly, people didn't understand it, people are not mature enough. Okay, it's easy to make fun of the old communists. But now, from what I gather with you, this rhetoric, which was then decried as totalitarian, is now massively returning in democratic Europe and not only there. It started, I remember, even more directly than France, Ireland, when the first referendum was no. The reaction was a purely pedagogical one. It was not people, you know, Vox Populi, Vox Dei, people said their opinion, it was
This was the wrong result. What did we do wrong? Where did we make the mistake? Not explaining it to the people and so on and so on. And then it was very humiliating. The top Irish politicians went to Brussels and got the lesson and promised that they will organize it better. And they did it. So we are literally approaching an epoch where, like, I think it's a great mystery, yes, what will happen now in Greece, because those effectively in power, and I'm not a paranoiac, I'm not saying that in some castle between Maastricht and Brussels they are meeting, but nonetheless, there is something like a chaotic global strategy of those in power. I think that they are now literally considering different options how to somehow block democracy there, how to organize a good result. We are, so, you know, when people are saying, or when I'm saying, democracy, the way we knew it, is approaching to an end, we are not engaged in some crazy leftist rhetorics. Look around, it's literally true. And I'm not only blaming Europe, let me repeat another of my old stories. Remember what happened in the fall of 2008 when President Bush proposed to the Congress the first big measure, $750 billion to save the banks. Congress first voted 2/3 against, and it was a wrong decision. So they all came together, Bush, McCain, Obama, and they basically give the message to the congressmen. Listen, we don't have time now for this democratic bullshit. We need the money. In 1 week, the Congress voted 2/3 the opposite. And again, this is not a joke. It's also not simply a plot. We shouldn't be idealists here and claim, ooh, bad guys, politicians want to deprive us. No, I even allow for a certain degree of sincerity, in the sense that effectively there was a financial crisis. If you don't, this is why we should question the system itself. It's not just bad people. The global capitalist system, the way it functions in its irrational financial trends and so on, it allows less and less for democracy. So don't moralize too much. The church is moralizing it here. I was shocked. You know what Vatican said? They're always the voice of, you know, as every rational Protestant, I claim Antichrist is on earth. It's called the Pope in Rome and so on, no? And you know what Vatican said? They said, the big representative of Vatican, I quote him, if not in this, in another of my books, he said openly, it's crucial to maintain today that the crisis today, it's not a crisis of capitalism, but a moral crisis. I think exactly the opposite. There were always evil people. There were always people like, you know, in my most evil spirit, I wanted to write a defense of Bernard Madoff. Not seriously, but the problem is not Madoff. Madoffs are all the time around. The problem is, how was the space open to them to do this? I'm sick and tired of this moralistic critique, you know, evil financial capitalist and so on and so on. The problem is, as you said, that capitalism itself, with its movement to mostly virtual financial speculations and so on and so on, how today the way to create wealth is no longer at least the old, it's false ideological, but the old capitalist dream of, you know, a guy who works fanatically for a decade, create something. No, this is not how you do it today. You're an idiot if you act like this today.
Yeah, so to leave some space to democracy in this hall also, I will just pose my last question to both of you, which is actually connected to the whole discussion.
But as Tariq said, democracy will be combined with the pressure of the two.
And with discipline, of course. So my question is a nice parallel made by Michael Hart recently. When I asked him about some global anti-global movements, he made a parallel and compared it to ecstasy, which may sound surprising, but actually what he said is, you come there, you have a good time, and then you go home and you fell in depression. And my question is, you have, Slavoj, also written about it in The Guardian on the Occupy Wall Street movement. And in a few days, a very important movement will start in Frankfurt with Occupy European Central Bank. So the movement is spreading all around Europe. My question is, what is actually needed to come from the squares to actually some sort of institution? Help me, please, Tariq.
Institutionalization. Repeat it, write it 10 times.
I'll do my homework. So that's my question, actually.
Well, look, the Occupy movements are an extremely significant development, and one should not underwrite that. One should not underplay that at all, because it is a new generation, large, small, different parts of the world, which is saying enough. We've had enough. We don't like what we are seeing. We are hostile to the system, which is a very important start. But again, today or yesterday, the indignados in Madrid occupied Puerto del Sol, occupied it in tens of thousands, much, much larger. That's, you know, the Occupy movement, in a sense, did start in the Arab world and in Europe and spread. So they are different movements with different strengths, different weaknesses. But in my opinion, of course, in order to the next phase of the Occupy movements, has to move beyond the occupation of public space to the occupation of political space, to challenge the existing parties, however they want to do it, to come up with even, you know, 5 or 10 key demands. This is what we want, to mobilize even more people, because they say 1%, 99%, it's slightly demagogic, because we know that not all that 99% is for them. If the size would be very different, but it's a good one, but it's not exactly accurate. But how to make it accurate? And what will make it accurate is actually moving forward now, beyond this, to come up not with old-style, bureaucratic-style parties, but certainly even with social movements which suggest 10 things, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. This is what we are fighting for. It's achievable if you join us. It's not achievable within the system. The thing Slavoj pointed out about the bailouts and how their democracy was circumvented, it's, you know, the Democrats had won, and Obama went to the House of Representatives where some of the Democrats were resisting the bailouts and said, you just do what Bush is asking. My election, in other words, my election means nothing. You just do what we are telling you to do, otherwise our system is going to collapse, which is why his economic policies, and there are many economists tearing their hair out, haven't been different. And this Occupy movement in the United States is partially not a big protest against all that. So I just feel, and I tell them when I speak to them in Princeton or the Bay Area, I said, this is tremendous, great. Do think now on how, I don't even want to tell you, think for yourselves how we can take this forward. Because simply coming here once a year and saying we started the movement is good, but it's not enough. We have to think about how to take it forward, and that's even equally important for Spain, where you had huge movements, really huge movements, in occupying public spaces in big cities and in small cities. And 1 week later, after the, or some months later, the right won a huge majority. And the two are not in tandem. This is why the French business, which is happening now, offers some models to the Occupy movement, certainly in the rest of Europe, and who knows, perhaps even the United States.
I have a question, actually. You showed your support in Zuccotti Park at the Occupy Wall Street movement, but on the other hand, recently you published an article where you quoted Jacques Lacan and said what you are searching is actually a new master. So it seems to me you're more pessimistic than Tariq is, or not?
No. It's, it works, yes. It's basically, I put it in my own words, what you said now, that this pure protest movement is not enough. If you remain at that level, you are effectively calling for a new master. This is what worried me a little bit, but now I read they are getting better. Namely, the original indignados What worried me, I said this last year here even, I think. You remember, they had a list of demands, we all agree, basically, welfare state, ecology, dignity, and so on. And then they said they distrust the entire political class, not just left and right, but they still operated not in the sense of we don't trust you, we will do it alone, but in the sense of a demand. And I was asking then, my God, they are constructing a space for an X. Like, whom are they addressing? Not themselves. They were literally creating the space of a new master, and we already have one of these new masters outside standard political parties. They are the bank experts, which are incidentally, that's the irony also with Obama, which are usually the guys from the very circles who screwed up this crisis. No, like Timothy Geithner comes from the banks who ruined us, and so on and so on. So, but maybe another thing along the same lines. You know, first, there is one reproach that we always hear. Stop your stupid criticism if you don't have concrete solutions. This is a petit bourgeois stupidity. Let me give you another example. What about ecology? We know we are approaching a crisis. We don't know solutions. A clear, simple solution. Does this mean that we shouldn't outline the problem or what? Or take even a more pathetic example, fighting cancer, or I'm doing it, diabetes. We don't know how to, we know just moderately how to control diabetes. Does this mean we shouldn't talk about it? This is a kind of a totally false ideological blackmail. Second thing, you know, the situation is difficult. Why? Because what we are clearly aware, somewhere in the back of our minds, is that we can play these games of making system more efficient and so on and so on, but, and here I agree with you if one is to believe the title of your text published now in Croat, that sooner or later the question will have to be raised of capitalism as such. And this is the big problem. You don't play with this. There are serious problems here. We are Marxists. You know what this means? This means that, if anything, Marx was fully aware of the great revolutionary force, productivity, and so on of capitalism. You don't play with this. But on the other hand, you know, never forget that today's global capitalism is not a unified, homogeneous place where all you can do is just follow neoliberal ideology of international bankers and so on. Look, a good, let me just to conclude mention one or two good examples. I remember, I don't especially like him, he was really a little bit totalitarian, but nonetheless, the late of 90s, I think, there was this financial crisis in Southeast Asia, and Mahathir Mohamad of Malaysia did some things with the banks controlling the flux. I remember The Economist, big front page. Ooh, madman, he will ruin it. He triumphantly succeeded, saving the crisis there and so on. Look at, not exactly our ideal state, look at Singapore. They have 15% growth. Okay, one don't want, but what I'm saying is that spaces are still open and things can be done here, which is why I fully agree with your deep skepticism of Obama. I wonder if you would concede nonetheless one point. I appreciate the entire debate about healthcare. I totally admitted that the actual economic result is a total compromise, nothing. But what I like is that a debate was triggered in the United States, which on the one hand obviously disturbs the very foundations of American ideology. You know that now they dragged healthcare reform even to Supreme Court, that it's against constitution, limits freedom of choice. So it is a fundamental ideological debate. At the same time, that's what I like about it. It's not some crazy proposal. It's something that works in many European countries, in Canada itself. With all the problems, basically it works. This is, I think, a good topic for modest steps that we can take. Start a debate which really disturbs our ideological predominant prejudices, but where what you propose is totally feasible. Nobody can accuse Obama in this case that, oh, he wants something crazy, total communism or whatever. He wants something that functions in many countries and so on. So again, this is the art of politics today, I claim. While, of course, leaving the horizon open for the urgency is not our choice. Of more radical measures, grab all the opportunities, opportunistically in a good sense. Here I want to ask you a benevolent questions. Question one, short. It's a very, I really mean it, benevolent but slightly skeptical one. I wonder you, here comes my evil nature. By nature, I'm evil, as all humans are. Okay, you said, oh, if only they were to occupy, for example, I know it was a metaphor, not literally, a metaphor, one of Thessaloniki or whatever. My question to you is very simple. And then what? What do you expect? I mean, I'm just here a terrible pessimist. I think that if I were, now I'm the bad guy, in the sense of those who want the failure of Greece. I would say, okay, perfect. Let them have a city, and then let's do everything possible to cause a catastrophe there, to give them a lesson once forever that you don't mess with this. How to prevent this? What to do? I mean, I'm ready to sell my mother into slavery for your Thessaloniki experiment to succeed, but would it have had a chance to succeed? Just my skepticism.
Just two other comments on what you said, and then I will come back to Thessaloniki. Yeah, exactly, the Thessaloniki commune. On ecology, I think, actually, Slavoj, it's true we don't have all the solutions. But again, some solutions are there. But capitalism is incapable of doing them, because especially on the ecological level, you do need to have some planning on a global scale. You know, you cannot have the free market. In order to save the planet, you have to have social economic planning, which means, you know, even on internal levels, for instance, to give you one example, the United States, the largest country, most powerful country in the world, a system which reverses the decisions made in the 20s and 30s of making the motor car the central way to travel in that country and bringing back in a cheap and efficient way the railway system. It can be done within capitalism. You don't have to.
Would you also agree here? Yeah. Now, step, because he's not yet here, to our good friend Michael Hart, I claim, would you also agree that this means we should, if not cut with it, at least limit the scope of this pseudo-Deleuzian metaphoric of micromolecular and so on? We need to rehabilitate large-scale decisions. We
yes.
shouldn't be afraid of it.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. I agree completely on that. So the ecology, from that point of view, is a very important, you know, everyone moans about it. Oh, the planet is being done, this, that. No political leadership anywhere in the world has said what we are discussing today. That it can't be done on its own. This is something which you need the collaboration of continents, not just regions, continents, not just countries, continents, if we're going to save the planet from the fate which many, many people are now predicting over the next 200 years. The population is growing, not enough water, not enough food, and people still want two cars and two homes. So you see, it's now as if ecology is almost dictating what we need to do, which is completely against the basic instincts and basic functioning of capital. Okay, let's come to Thessaloniki now. Now, Slavo, you can't have it both ways. When I said we need to take a city, I didn't have a fully worked out program. But I would say that Thessaloniki, which is the second largest city in Greece, could then begin to have on every level some things which began to happen but then stopped, for instance, in Argentina. When in a city as large as Buenos Aires, when the system collapsed, and when within 2 weeks, 2003, yeah, during the crash, 2003, they had done, the Argentine government had done everything. The World Bank, the IMF, and the US Treasury Department asked them to do. Every single measure had been carried out, and the banks collapsed. The politicians were vilified, hated, they couldn't do anything, people's savings were in these bank accounts. Within the space of 3 weeks, four presidents collapsed. And what did the people do? They said, okay, in a city like Buenos Aires, huge, huge city, very similar to European cities, as you know, people began to meet in their own localities, including the upper middle class localities, to say, how are we going to carry on? You had large popular assemblies all over the city who would meet once a month in a larger gathering with delegates to decide how to keep the city going on a very primitive level, but how to keep it going, and they did. Workers who took over their factories and began to produce goods as best they could in those factories and use them as barter to exchange with other people. Now, this was a model which actually did have an impact on that country and enabled Kirchner, when he came in, to default, not completely, but to a large extent, on the debt that Argentina had incurred. And the IMF didn't do anything, and the Americans accepted it because they knew there was huge popular support for it. Now, it's something on that sort. And what this did is also not just solve the problems immediately, but also politicize and make the people very conscious. And in Thessaloniki, let us say that, for instance, given the fact that there are so many people out of work, a popular representative assembly has discussed very concretely what is the work available, how many people are doing it, who is going to do this, how much money this is, how can this money be spent, etc., etc., starting from a very trivial level of day-to-day management and then discussing also the problems which confront the whole of Greece, but essentially keeping the bankers and keeping the local corrupt politicians in Thessaloniki at bay. I once met the mayor of Thessaloniki a few years ago, and I didn't quite suggest this, but I suggested some of the things. He said, he came up to me, he said, I'm an independent. I've been elected mayor of Thessaloniki. And if you ever want an account of how we function in Greece, the degree of corruption by both parties, I will give you so much material you can fill volumes on it. Now, to remove these people and work with representative, popularly elected representatives, even for a month, would have shown it could have been done on a national scale. And on a national scale, there are many things to do, and it may come to this. I'm not joking. If the Greeks manipulate the will of the people, however it's been expressed, then, you know, it's not totally impossible that something like this could happen. Those people will then totally lose faith in parliament. Usually when that's happened, it's the far right who benefits, by the way. Usually. And in Greece too, as Slavoj pointed out, there are very unhealthy nationalist currents attacking immigrants and saying, you know, build Greece and all that. It's a process we can see. The one problem they have, on a lighter note, is for the ultra-Greek nationalists, what to do about the food. Because most of the food in Greece that you eat, as you know, is Ottoman food from Anatolia. What to do? I actually discussed this with one person a few years ago. I said, what would you do about the food? You know, just to provoke. They said, you know, we have all the documents of what they used to eat in ancient Greece, and we can restore all that now. I said, could you tell me just two or three dishes, because I quite like cooking? Nothing.
Or you can change names, like after the Turkish invasion of Cyprus, they changed in one day. I was in London then. In all Greek restaurants, Turkish coffee is now called Greek coffee.
Yeah, that's fine. One solution, yeah. That's fine. It fits in with the times.
But you know, sorry, I will not go on long, but here we should prolong the debate because I still see, I have here an evil mind. So yeah. Many problems, like you said, what to do with money? What money? Who controls the money? And so on. I mean, you know what I mean? Here I think, you know what is my primordial fear? And I hope we all share this fear. It's that if there will be a prospect for some kind of authentic leftist coalition in authentic, whatever, popular pressure, some parties yeah. in Greece, how to prevent this reasoning, which is almost the ABC if you are a right winger, to say, perfect, let them have it and let's make it sure that it'll be chaos, hunger and collapse to teach the people a lesson. This is it. Night and day we should think about this. How to prevent this. That's my big fear. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. Yeah. Because whenever you are in dynamic, half-revolutionary situation, I mean, of course there is a risk of this. But because ordinary, now I will sound like from a cheap Hollywood melodrama, but ordinary people, this will be horrible what I will say, do have right to their normal lives. And yes. Certain time, they have the right to say, sorry, we have now to start function normally. Then you have to provide. And this is for me so important. Well, as to Argentina, I agree with you, but nonetheless, don't forget that there was an ominous figure between the two, the glorious moment of people organizing themselves and Kirchner. Unfortunately, in between the two, there was Eduardo Duhalde, the corrupted guy who stabilized the situation at the level of state.
This is also
I talk too much, I'm sorry.
No. You're right. I think that in the case of Greece, you know, just on an elementary scale, they are told if you ditch the euro, there will be disaster. All the Greek economists I have been speaking to from the left, Kostas Lapitsas, others, say the exact opposite. Say, how can we be in more of a disaster than what is happening to us now? When almost half the country is out of work, when civil servants are going back to their villages to grow their own food and live, how can we be in a worse disaster? And one elementary thing that would happen, you know, again on a sort of small scale, but not so small, is that a reversion to the drachma and an immediate devaluation, you would have a massive influx of tourism in Greece. At the moment, it's very expensive as a city, as a country, you know. It's you would have a massive influx of tourism, real tourism, and also support and solidarity tourism from people all over Europe who would go to try and defend this system. Just on one level, that would bring in a lot of money immediately, which at the moment they don't have, because tourism is right down in Greece.
Can I just very briefly say that? First, I must say I had and still have a certain sympathy for euro, not because of any European mystique, but I think that the American extreme right, in my, you know, this is the guilty low pleasures, I like this, you know, left behind, you know, who is left behind, this extreme right winger, religious fundamentalist, you know, they are the opinion of the true American right. For them, the enemy is Europe. For them, behind Arab terrorists is some European consortium, usually some Swiss banker, some ex-KGB agent, and so on. And for them, euro is a mega plot to unsettle, to dethrone US dollar. This was, for me, the positive aspect of euro. And for me, I agree with you, the tragedy is who took over the euro. Instead of making it an instrument, which it could have been, of different economic politics, euro is now, we all know what it is. Second thing that I agree with you is that, you know, this is another aspect of what I tried to warn people about. Don't accept the way those in power define a problem. Like, they often present something as a catastrophe, and then, oh my God, if this happens, it's the end of the world. Well, sometimes it's not. Sometimes when they say, but are you aware? If we do this, euro will fall, it's the end. Sometimes we have to keep cool nerves and say, no, maybe it's not. Let's take the risk. Our worries are not your worries.
Exactly.
Sometimes we can say, no, the euro that you are defending now, this Brussels bankers euro, maybe this is precisely one of the principal obstacles to save what is worth saying in European legacy. Don't allow the enemy to dictate your worries, what you worry about. They should worry about their problems. Sometimes these are also our problems, but my God, sometimes they are not. And the point is to keep cold nerves, not to lose nerves. Oh my God, panic, now euro and so on. It can fall apart, so what? At some point one has to be ready to take the risk.
Okay, let's be ready for questions from the audience. So we have two mics, one is here, one is somewhere there. Just raise your hand and let's go on with questions. We have two questions in the first row. First the lady on the left and then our Greek Cypriot friend. Yeah.
Hello. First, I would like to ask Mr. Horvat, Srećko, I will start to raise the question in English, but is it possible later on to speak my language, Croatian, what means that I want to be sure that Mr. Tarik will have that things and can understand me?
Yeah, but we need, yes, if someone brings headphones
okay.
For Tarik.
If it's not easy, I will try in English. I will speak in English. Oh, well, before my question, I have need to give you two informations for the sake of quality information, additional information. First one is that Malaysian Premier Mahathir, okay, started with that measure very successful, and that it's true that it was blamed in some media for that measures, which means controlling their own capital circulation, bank, etc. But also it's true that on the other side, in some other circles, he was very admired. And that's the reason for that, because he is first who started to place an idea about Muslim dinner, and he started even to produce it in some country, not in Malaysia, but in Iraq. And after that, Muslim dinner, gold currency. Okay, sorry. Muslim currency called gold dinner. And after, the first country who started to produce is Iraq. And after that, a lot of surrounding countries started to do the same. But the whole process was interrupted in the moment or after moment the Pope invited Malaysian Premier to visit Vatican, and his idea interrupted it.
So on what side are you?
I'm talking to you.
You
decide.
Okay,
okay, thank you. The second information, for the sake of quality information, is that in the month,
could we ask you maybe to come to the question? I think there are a lot of people who would like also to pose a question.
Ah, so they are protesting.
Excuse
okay.
Me?
They are protesting.
Applausing, but occupying
okay.
And so on.
Okay. So Mr. Žižek was speaking about Greece. In the month that started that stories about lazy Greek, the level of production was much more higher in Greece than in Great Britain. And it's applied also for the quarter before that. So the story has strong background, as you know. And that is my question. I'm now afraid to raise the question because the public is, let's try. The reason this book of Mr. Ali Tariq is trigger me to tell a story of a three president. Mr. Taliarik wrote the book about this president. I will tell a short story about another president and third one.
Please, question. I think this is the question.
Thank you for your understanding.
So first we will take more questions and then Tariq and Slava will answer. There is one question, second question, and so on. Okay, and...
Why are you privileging the right wing?
Okay, then we go to the left.
Hello, I'm Gaspar Tamás from Budapest. So it was very dangerous to accuse people like Slavoj Žižek and Tariq Aliyev of not sufficient radicalism, but let me just draw your attention to one basic fact about contemporary capitalism, which is the following. The majority of the working age population is not working and is not going to be working. And the relationship between production and livelihood has been interrupted. There is a moment in which the conflict between labor and capital is being dwarfed politically by the cleavage between those who don't and won't ever work and those who participate in the labor-capital continuum. Now, this has motivated an extreme transformation of the contemporary state in which the non-productive strata of society have to face a stark choice. They won't ever work productively in the Marxist sense, never, given the technological changes and so on and so forth. So therefore, they will either be kept alive by the state, or starve, or be reduced to servitude. Now, in the neoliberal situation in which state resources had been diminished, there is an enormous competition for the ever-dwindling state resources. That's a struggle of life and death. And the contemporary state is the decider, is in a position to decide with a dwindling and collapsing welfare state to decide who will die and who will live. And the decision is being made increasingly on a biopolitical basis, racial, health, age, and gender. The propaganda against the aged is, you know, it's new, it's newer than racism. It's getting ever more strong, ever more stronger, and also the non-productive strata, such as intellectuals, artists, students, the lazy, the non-working. You know, when Sarkozy said memorably his phrase about la France qui se lève tôt, you know, the France that gets up early, meaning that those who are not getting up early will be deprived of all aid, moral support, and material means of livelihood. So now we are facing a struggle at least as grim and serious as the old class struggle of the 19th century, and we'll be facing sharp and violent battles. And this won't be solved by the welfare state. The welfare state can provide for the workers, but it cannot provide for the people who didn't, don't, and won't ever work. We are facing, again, such a dramatic choice as in the 30s. We are facing a choice between revolution and counter-revolution, and this is no joke. And here, the micro molecular changes may be too late now. Thank you.
Maybe just take two questions.
No, I will get confused. Okay. And if you, I just don't see the point of your initial step at us not being radical enough, because in my new book, which will appear in a couple of months, I'm crazy. What I mean is that I write precisely about this. I follow here Frederick Jensen, who is not exactly the greatest master of economy, but in his short book on capital, he focuses on this, on the deeply changed structural role of unemployment. We have today, it's not just that we have the reserve army to keep the pressure on workers. We have, as you said, people who technological and so on reasons simply become not only temporarily but non-employed but permanently unemployable. Then Jensen puts in the same series the whole countries which are symbolically put the so-called rogue countries. You are like out, lazy country. You are excluded from from productive circulation of capital. Then I would say what Jensen neglects, something like the students protesting, even more tragic, people who, while they are studying, are forced to accept they don't even have a minimal chance of getting a job for what they are educated, and so on and so on. And I would say that many people, even my conservative friend, we can make fun of him, but I wouldn't go as far as Habermas, Peter Sloterdijk. He may be crazy, but he sees the problem with his totally crazy proposal to celebrate the rich. And I agree with you, this is the problem, because the left, moderate left, has an answer, and I don't accept it. It is almost the only really original leftist idea of last decades. It is that Belgian guy, Van Parijs, the universal, how do you call it, income or basic, or much better term, I think it's more correct theoretically, the way they call it in Brazil, renta básica, basic rent. But as Van Parijs himself makes it clear, this is the way to save capitalism. His problem is the following one. He accepts this. Capitalism is the only truly productive system. But it, as you pointed out, it engenders larger and larger, at a much more radical scale than before, strata of unemployable and so on and so on. How can we have both at the same time? Capitalism at its most productive and not victimization of the unemployed. His answer is the basic rent. For structural reasons, not only economic, but even symbolic reasons, like I hope we would agree that if you imagine this solution, I can already see tremendous explosions of envy, resentment, and so on. I don't want even to think what this would have meant socially. But I deeply agree with you that something is happening today from the micro level to the level of the whole nations, populations, the whole global capitalism is precisely not global in the sense that it is creating its own white spaces, excluded spaces, and so on and so on.
I would move on to other questions. Or do you want to add a comment on this as well? Or
okay. What I said.
Yeah, of course, because you're confirming all the time.
what Tamar said is very important in a way, and he's right to reprimand us for not having discussed it. It's true, but it raises a whole set of new questions for which we, we do need a longer discussion. That the decline of productive capitalism, industrial capitalism, in Europe and the United States doesn't necessarily mean that this form of capitalism has ceased to exist globally. I would say today that in a situation where China is the workshop of the world, where China is playing the role which more or less British capitalism did in the 19th and early 20th century, producing a large amount of goods that were bought or imposed on the rest of the world. The Chinese don't impose them. They just produce them so cheaply that they'll end up everywhere. There is nothing in most parts of the world. You walk into a market, you will not be able to find too many things that are not made in China. Which means that in China and in Vietnam to a certain extent, you have a form of capitalism which is not so new. It's very similar in some ways to what we have been through. Of course, there are differences as well, what we have been through in Europe. I give you, just to demonstrate this, an interesting anecdote. An old acquaintance of mine, professor of history at Cambridge, was invited by the Chinese Politburo's think tank to give a talk on Britain. He was a bit surprised, but he accepted. And he said, I would like to speak on this. And they said, no. We would like you to speak on just answering for us this question: how did Britain avoid a revolution in the 19th century? And he went and said, this is how. And they said, and there was no democracy in Britain in the 19th century? And he said, no. And they looked at each other and smiled. Now, the point they were making is that they realized that the productive forces in China are so explosive that the move from the countryside, where there have been even small peasant uprisings, into the towns out of desperation is so strong that you don't just have marginal populations in China, you have a huge industrial development of the new type since China became this power. So what you say, I think, is essentially applicable to Europe and possibly to most of North America. I don't think it applies as yet to China or to India or to Vietnam or even to South Korea or Taiwan, countries which, whatever their other flaws, and there are many, are not yet in that same situation. I don't think capitalism globally can do without some industrial base, simply in order to keep going. So what to do with the situation in Europe, that's a very important question. It's a question which capitalism cannot answer. And it is a question for which you need a new type of state, a new type of system, whatever you want to call it. Socialism, post-socialism, communism, whatever. But the capitalist state cannot deliver that. The danger in that, of course, politically speaking, is you have these crazy explosions like you're having in Europe, where they're targeting migrants, they're targeting Romani people, precisely because they cannot find any solution to their own problems at all. I mean, Sarkozy actually was one of the few presidents who boasted about deporting Romani people out of France. And they do it, and more politicians will do it, by saying, this is the real problem, that is the danger. And arising also from what you said, in what I think does apply to a certain extent to Europe and America, is the question, if that is the case, and it probably is, what is the revolutionary subject today? Big question.
But can I just briefly? Nonetheless, I agree with both of you. I will try to mediate. I agree with your level is this Western post-work society, then the workshops. But I claim that nonetheless there is a third, even lower level. Congo and so on, countries which, except for some minerals or natural resources, they are simply out. They are considered not even worse. So this is, for me, the whole tragedy. There is also another, the unemployment is not only unemployment on the top, as it were. It's also unemployment of at the bottom. Take countries like both Congos, they're a tragedy, the French, Brazzaville, and Kinshasa. Apart, the West is there interested, big companies in a couple of minerals or oil, and they don't care. They simply vegetate all the majority there, no? Point two, even in China, you must know it, it's not as unambiguous as you said, because, you know, they do have now their own slums, their own surplus. Everyone cannot find work, so The same tension is gradually reproduced within, up to a point, I agree with you, within China itself, which is why, as you said nicely, the situation is so explosive in China.
Before we move on to the upper part of the cinema to take some more questions, we have an important information from Occupy Frankfurt.
Yeah, I just want to, I'm Thomas Seibert coming from Frankfurt. I just want to interrupt the analytical discussion for a practical intervention because that's it, that is significant for the time we're living in. You know that the role Germany is playing, and therefore we didn't have so strong protests up to now in Germany because everybody wants to stick on the side of the winning government. Therefore, we decided to make a special action with the forces we have, which means we just need 5,000 people to attack the European Central Bank in Europe just for one single day, and we planned that coming for the next week. The German powers immediately are reacting hysterically. They have made the decision now. They banned all the action planned for the next week. They decided to close down the Occupy camp Wednesday evening. And they even have done one thing which they haven't done since the late 1970s. Up to now, 480 individuals got an order by police that it is strictly forbidden for them to enter Frankfurt for the time from Wednesday to Sunday. So at the moment, the German left and what is and all the other people of the movements are deciding how to react, because it seems as if there probably only one possibility is left for us, and we are not sure because it's the possibility left for us by the powers, is to attack militantly Frankfurt. Because the problem will be, if the ban is not lifted to Wednesday, then all the people who want to come to Frankfurt will not have a place to resemble, because all the places are closed down. That means that only the core groups of the left will have the possibility to go into Frankfurt. So we are not quite sure what we do in the times left for us. We are trying to play out all the juridical games we have, but what they do is they will play on time because they want to save the ban up to Wednesday, Thursday. So what we need at least from this, because we have here, I think, 700 people somehow or 600 people in the room, what we need, if possible, from tomorrow on, a solidarity address of hundreds of people here in Zagreb, and of all those guys like Tariq and Slavoj and whoever is here, that we can release it to the public from tomorrow on, by all means given in our hands for that. And then, of course, I have to skip over all the questions we have to you, what is possible for you to do if the ban is not lifted. Thank you very much for your support.
We will do it.
No, so, yeah. I totally support you because, you know, is it true that the ruling class is losing their ability to rule? They are getting, what I would have done is, and if I were to be the bank, those in power, I would say, fine, come, I would serve you cakes, let's debate for one day, so that the next day we can return to our, you know. So this is, in a way, let's try to be optimists. Maybe this is a good sign. They are losing nerves. Thank you.
I agree with Slavoj. It seems crazy to me what they're doing. I mean, we know the German state, what it's capable of. It's done it before. The Berufsverbot laws that were passed, the way they, you know, not that I one agrees with what the Bader-Meinhof people did, but there was a huge movement behind them. You know that better than me. But they have operated like this before, at times when they felt that they were, you know, they couldn't deal with it in any other way. They felt that, the Social Democrats in Germany. They did it. But for them to stop an occupation of the area outside the European Central Bank is extremely defensive. I mean, it's unbelievable. So congratulations. And I mean, honestly, if I were to say something contradictory, if it becomes known that they banned a demonstration outside the European Central Bank, that in itself is a victory. Because you can organize another occupation, but this should be publicized as to why have they done this. You know, this is the sort of future of Europe, unified Germany, and they've started doing this there. It's unbelievable, really. I mean, no other government in Europe has done this so far. Or maybe some, which we don't know about, but no major country in Europe has done this, and for the German government to do it is very revealing of their mentality.
So definitely we agree Genoa could repeat, unfortunately, so we will try. Why unfortunately? Because they smashed the protest and people were like beaten and so on. What? But anyway, we will try to send a message of solidarity tomorrow, and we will get signatures by all the people from here, and we will speak about Frankfurt also the other days. We could continue with some questions now from the upper part.
As European citizens.
Thanks a lot for such a concrete and short question, and I would also like to ask other people not to occupy the mics. There is a person behind you.
I'm here from Zagreb, and I would like to put a question, not expressing my opinions as many people here in the public would like, but my question is, let's say, how do you see the situation in our country, in my country, in Croatia, which is now, let's say, Social Democratic Party is ruling, but it is for us, or for me, Liberal Party. We haven't started yet the process of taking capitalism as something, let's say, question of, under question, because Mr. Žižek says the capitalism is the problem is itself. Is it the problem for some people here outside? No, it's not the problem. They like capitalism. And they make it legitimate here in Croatia. We sitting here are not the people, we are 100 or let's say 50 or 200 people here who like to hear this criticism and theory. But we start now with the capitalism, which started already 20 years ago, but it's not really what are we now coming to. So my question is, how to make another opinion or atmosphere in the public opinion, how to make illegitimate this capitalism?
So before we pass the mic on the right side of the upper part of the cinema, so please already raise the hand and the mic will come to you. I would just shortly try to answer the question. As a Croatian, I wouldn't agree it's only 50 or 200 people. It's actually more than 500 people in the room, maybe not now. And it's not only this room. We collected, not we, but our comrades, 50,000 signatures for the Cvjetni trg. Workers in Dalmatia are protesting, students protested, and so on and so on. So there actually is a movement, and not only us don't like capitalism. So that's just a correction.
And just one phrase, you know, it's not, I think, as simple as you put it. Even ordinary people outside, they do somehow feel that something is wrong in capitalism. The operation they try to do is to read it as some secondary failure, not failure. Like, this is why I think we are now getting in some parts of Eastern Europe what I called, in Habermasian terms, verspätete or belated anti-communism. Like, the idea is, we have capitalism, which is supposed to be freedom, prosperity. We don't have freedom, prosperity. One paranoiac explanation, because we don't have real capitalism. Communist mafia bands are still retaining control, pulling secretly the strings, and so on and so on. Or then you can have other versions, international banking, blaming parts of capitalism. So I think precisely this is how ideology replies to this feeling of discontent, trying to save the notion, concept itself, and blaming some particular deviation. Just briefly, the other question, European citizens and so on, the only way for me to convince people to move beyond their nation-state citizenship is to play a little bit of positive paranoia and to emphasize that if we will not unite, then God help us, because the enemy is united. The enemy capitalist international. That's why the only way for us to fight it is to become transnational ourselves. If not, then the enemy will just play one country against the other, and so on and so on.
Yeah, maybe just one last question from the right, if there is one. There are no questions, so if you didn't have an opportunity to ask a question, we will have an opportunity tomorrow already from 10 in the morning in Kazalište ZKM. Tarik and Slava will probably also be present, if not reading Hegel. Please, a big applause.